Ted, you were, have you always been in Pierre? Is Pierre your hometown?
What's that?
Is Pierre your hometown?
No. Raised over here in Hand County, Ree Heights. We lived on a farm northwest of Ree Heights.
How old were you when the war started?
Well, let's see, I'd have been, I would have been 23.
Tell me about that experience, if you could.
Well, of course, Pearl Harbor occurred on December 7th, 1941, and the draft went into effect shortly after that. And my draft number came up in that same month. And I didn't want to be drafted, and I had enrolled my last few months in college at South Dakota State, and the Marine recruiters were on campus giving physicals. So I took a physical, and then I passed. So the next day, there were 30 of us were sworn in as private first class in the Marines. Well, they would let us finish our last few months of college. Just right after graduation, then I got my orders to report to Quantico, Virginia. Out of the 30, there were three of us called first. They went by the start of the top of the alphabet.
And you're a B.
Yeah, Burge, Brown, and Breckenridge. We got down there. There were three of us there. So it went 3 months of what they called Officer Candidate School, and if you made that, then you're commissioned as second lieutenant. Then you went 3 more months, then you were ready to be assigned someplace. So I was sent down to Florida with amphibian tractors and then to California. And our battalion was formed up there in Camp Pendleton, California, first Armored Amphibian Battalion.
Had you ever been that far away from home before?
No, I had not, no. So our battalion was attached to the 4th Marine Division. They combat loaded in San Diego, 18,000 men, and we were attached to them. So we shipped out from there, the Guadalcanal. Then we went and made the landing on Guam, back to Guadalcanal. Then we made the landing on Okinawa, Easter Sunday, April 1, 1944. And while we were on Okinawa, the war ended in Europe. So then we were sent to Saipan. And while we were on Saipan, they dropped those two atom bombs. So Japan surrendered shortly after that. So then we were shipped back to California, came into Terminal Island, and then I went home in December of 1945, put on inactive duty. Well, I was still within the Marines until 1956, and then I turned in my, I was a captain by that time, I turned in my commission of no longer in the Marines. The Korean War was going on, and I didn't want to be involved in that, so that's how I got out. That's mm-hmm. how it happened. Yeah.
Tell me about the first time you went in or saw combat. Do you remember that experience? Can you tell us about that?
Yes. They would put us in the water about 2 miles from the beach. And we were the first wave. And had a destroyer marking the line of departure with a red flag. And when they lowered the red flag, that was the signal for us to go in. Now, the battleships had been shelling the beach. And then the planes were strafing and bombing the beach. So we would go in until we landed. But then the infantry, there would be about two waves of infantry and amphibian tractors behind us, and then about 4 or 5 waves of infantry in landing boats. So they would just push right on through us when they got, and they had some of the terrible losses. But we actually didn't suffer anything like what they did. But that's that we were used later on if they wanted some support, artillery and so forth. So that that's the way it was handled. Okinawa was later, and the landing wasn't too bad. We lost about half our tanks on Guam, but Okinawa, we had a pretty easy landing. When we got further into the island, then we met resistance. There was a battalion of Marines going to push up this mountainside. Japs were up in the hills, and they needed artillery support. And they had a Ford Observer up there with the infantry, so he would call down to us, and he would give us a target, so then we would fire on that target. And that first day, we had just almost used all of our ammunition till they finally brought more up. Some of the emplacements were so strong, our 75 miller wouldn't knock them out. But there was a destroyer right off in the water. He had these 6-inch cannons. So we would fire around the smoke where that target was, and he would fire a 6-inch cannon and knock them out.
Now, you were involved in a lot of different actions, island to island to island. Well, did it, this is kind of silly, but were they different? Did it get easier? What as you progressed from island to island to island, how did that change for you? How did the that first step, that first, you know, going ashore change? Or did it?
Landing on Guadalcanal, we didn't make the initial landing. The 1st Marine Division had landed on Guadalcanal. There were still Japanese forces on the island, but they had already made the landing. So it wasn't that hard for us. Guam was the worst. That's where we lost so many tanks. And two of my best friends lost their lives there that first night on the beach. But I guess of the landing, the one at Guam was probably the most difficult.
Mm-hmm. Did you ever have a point before the atomic bombs dropped where you were starting to think about what's it going to be like to invade Japan?
Well, yes. They were starting to kind of prepare us. They're on Saipan. We got in new tanks and got equipment for that landing, which would have happened if they hadn't dropped the atom bomb.
What do you remember from that day when you finally heard word that war was over?
Oh, my. We were so elated. It was going on and on. But when they dropped those two atom bombs, we were pretty optimistic then that the war wouldn't last very much longer.
Did you get word back fairly quickly that these bombs had dropped, or how did you find out about it?
We heard about it there. We heard when they dropped the first one on Nagasaki, I guess, and the other was Hiroshima.
Mm-hmm.
But when we heard what happened, we thought then it couldn't last much longer.
What happened then for you? How long was it before you were back in the U.S., and what things were there for you to do then?
We were shipped back to the States in November of 1945.
Mm-hmm.
And then we put on inactive duty, and I went home to the farm out here in December, got there Christmas time in 1945.
What was that day like?
Oh, wonderful, yes, yes. But I did, I was just on inactive duty, but like I told you, I didn't want to get involved in another war, and they discouraged me from resigning this commission, but I did resign, and I was glad I did.
Mm-hmm. How old were you when you came back to Hand County? When you came back the first time, how old were you?
When I came back from overseas?
Yep.
Well, that was 1945. I guess I was 27.
27?
Yeah.
Did you look at the world any differently? Did you look at Hand County any differently when you came back?
Well, it was so different. It was good to be home, but getting back to farm, it was pretty quiet compared to where he'd been. And two of my friends that lost their lives on Guam that first night, their wives wrote me letters. Got to live on Guadalcanal. One was little Scotty from Iowa, and the other was Tim Bourgeois from Louisiana. So they asked me if I would come and see them. So I did. It must have been February of 46. I got on a train and went to Chicago, and I met Elaine there. And
Elaine is?
That was Scotty's wife.
Okay.
And then I went on the train, went down to New Orleans. That's where Jimmy's wife, Dolly, where she lived. And I met her family for the first time. They lived just right below the city, right below New Orleans. And they were so nice to me. They just welcomed me and the wonderful southern seafood. And her dad was very dominant. He would tell them, bring Ted this, bring Ted that. And they just treated me wonderful. So I was there about maybe 10 days, I suppose. Then I came back to back home. But Dolly and I became friends. So then in November of 1946, I went back and we got married in New Orleans. And then brought her to South Dakota in February of 1946, right in the dead of winter.
A little culture shock from New Orleans to, to South Dakota in the wintertime.
Yeah, it was. But we went to Rapid City, and Rapid City is a pretty nice climate. So that's where we lived there 6 years. And our children, Terry and my daughter, Cheryl, they were both born in Rapid City. And we moved here in March of 1953. Been here ever since. And my wife, in later years, she had trouble with her breathing and emphysema. And she passed away. Well, she was on oxygen the last, 5 or 6 years. She passed away in October of 1999. I still live in the same house that we built in 1953.
Mm. When you think back to those days being overseas, what do you think about? What do you remember most?
Well, Terry asked me to write up a narrative about World War II, and my friend Mrs. Hyde here in town, she read through the whole thing, and she said, well, you need to put more in there. Tell how you lived overseas. So I did. I told how we lived in tents when we were not on the front. And we used our helmet for a wash basin to wash ourselves and wash our clothes. And, when we were aboard ship, that was the best living conditions. We had good food, good place to sleep and all. And when we were in the combat area with these tanks, there were about 5 or 6 of us to a tank. And we would sleep with the tank, and we had a tarp, and we'd put 2 corners of tarp attached to the tank, and then 2 poles hold up the other. So we slept under there, so we were able to keep out of the rain when it got wet.
Are you still glad that you joined the Marines rather than wait to get drafted?
Oh, God, I a good friend of mine was in college down there at State when I was there, and he's the one that called me and told me he knew that I was in trouble with the draft. He said the Marine recruiters are on the campus. He said, I'm going to take the physical this morning, and I'll call you. He called me and said, it's not that bad. So I went over there, and I had passed it. And I always thank him for, because I was proud to be in the Marines. I always thank him because of him, I joined the Marines. That's what it amounted to.
Anything else you'd like to add as we wrap up?
Well, no. This friend, he was a big, rugged, athletic type boy, For some reason, he didn't make it down to Quantico. I couldn't figure that out. The first 3 months was really very hard. And they said, some of them wanted to go home. After a few days, they wanted to go home. They said, there's not any way you can go home unless you don't make it 3 months. Then we don't want you, and you can go back home. But my friend Gibb, time he came along, he had to stay in. So he ended up as a sergeant, and showed up down in Guadalcanal, and he was so upset. He came over with that 29th Marines, and he said the old colonel he thought was crazy, him walking up and down on the deck at night, and he was so down. And then later on, I see him on Okinawa, and they'd been up on the front, and he saw the Japs bayonets and wounded Marines, but he made it back all right. And he got back home, he finished at college at South Dakota State, and married a Michigan girl, and he's living in Michigan now. And I still hear from him, and so that was a big plus for me. So he did.
Well, Ted, thanks for spending time with us today, sharing your stories, and probably most importantly, thanks for your service.
Get your name.